Hello friends and family, and welcome to my channel. It's the end of August and time for another Korean pond update. In this episode I will do the normal checkup on the system, the fish, the water parameters. And we have had some issues in the pond during the month. I will go through, and in the end there will be a deep dive into water parameters. So let's start by looking at the pond as of today. During the month there has been some work on the filtering house. I know this is a little bit odd since I haven't uploaded the video about the roof build yet. But we're not in goal here, so there will be some more work going forward, and you will find another koi filter house build video within a month or so. In the bog filter, yeah, it's this time of the year it grows like crazy. It's not very long since I cut the edge, so it was totally visible, and now it's totally overgrown again. What is extra fun is the papyrus, the dwarf papyrus, that has grown like crazy. It's quite a cool plant. I have read resources online that claim that the dwarf papyrus can be overwintered at zone 9. And that should be possible to overwinter in my non-heated part of the greenhouse. So yeah, that's my aim for this plant. Let's see if it works. What I've been noticing during the month is that there are almost no algae at all growing on the walls. People might say that the thin algae layer on the walls is good for the fish. And that is totally true. The algae helps to clean the water. But on the other hand, I have a massive bog filter that cleans the water perfectly and outcompete the algae. So for me, it's not really an issue to have clean walls. And perfectly black walls make the koi look so much more beautiful. So that's excellent. So yeah, in the pond, most fish are in excellent condition. Last month we had spawning and they got a few sores and injuries. Most of it has recovered, except for this Doitsu platinum. Yeah, it's looking really clamped fins and sores on the body and breathing heavily. For those of you that don't know what Doitsu is, most people will explain it that it means without scales. But that is not totally true. Doitsu means German. You know, the scaleless fish were developed in food production in Germany, and it was named Doitsu, which means German. Obviously the scales have some sort of function for the fish, otherwise they wouldn't be there. So my experience is that they are very, very sensitive, and I haven't managed to keep a Doitsu alive for a very long time in my pond. I had decided not to add any more Doitsus, but I had a friend turning down her pond, and she gave me free fish. I told her I don't want the Doitsu, but she said take free or none of them. So that's the reason why the Doitsu is here. I have been trying to get rid of it the first few years, but after 4 or 5 years I was thinking that maybe this one makes it. But now we have an issue when it's got injured and really hard to recover from it. I don't know where this leads. He's still eating well, but looks really bad. I will not hesitate to take him out if I have to before the winter. It's a really big risk for the whole population in the pond to try to overwinter an unhealthy fish. So he have 2 months to recover. If not, I have to take that really, really hard decision. Too bad. Doitsu may work perfectly well in the traditional koi pond, given medications a few times a year to keep their health up. But in this kind of system where I cannot give medications, Doitsu is not for me. So that's too bad, and I learned my lesson. When I was so busy building the filter house, I got an alkalinity crash. It's all sorted out now, but I will talk a little bit more about that going forward in this video. But let's start with the basic water parameters. So this is the water parameters as of today. pH and KH is back to normal after the big alkalinity crash. Ammonia, as usual, perfect. The NO2 nitrate is still a little bit elevated. NO3 still very, very low, but detectable. PO4 phosphate is keep on rising during the late part of the season, and I will discuss that very soon as well. Temperature, yeah. It's swimming temperature, and I utilize this as often as possible to take a swim with my fish. So when it comes to the constantly increasing phosphate levels, I think I'm at that point now that I have the time to administer potassium nitrate addition to my pond, and I know by experience that if I add potassium nitrate, increasing potassium level, increasing nitrate level in the pond, the bog filter will start to deplete the phosphate in the system. I have also experienced when I add potassium nitrate to the pond, all my algae at the walls dies and put a pressure on the system. But now I'm in the perfect situation. I have the phosphate levels that I need to take care of. There's no algae growing on the walls, and I have time to put focus on it. So starting today, I will add 2 ppm of nitrate every day until I see a result in phosphate down and nitrate up, and then I will stop. Everything will be revealed in September Koi and Pond update, so please hit that subscribe button so you don't miss that. Yeah, actually I haven't shown the low-tech Wahlstad type of tub for a very long time. It looks really amazing. In the summer, when it started to fill up with mosquito larvae, I got some guppy fish from a friend to add to it. They spend 4 weeks in here eating all the mosquito larvae, and now they are back at their aquarium at their own home. So every koi and pond update I have been doing, the feeding has been done in the afternoon. However, I feed 3 times a day, so for this episode I will show the little bit more slow morning feeding. So enjoy that. So surface skimmer off, and we are ready for a morning feed. The fish are a little bit of a slow starters in the morning, but yeah, still happy and hungry, and this is the first feeding of the day, and they get another one when I get back from work, and a third one in the evening. That's all the time when temperature is above 19 or 20 degrees. So normally I would be in my car on the way to my work now, and I never see how fast they eat. We are at the 5 minute mark when Koi should have finished their food, or I am feeding too much. So yeah, a good learning. I need to decrease the morning feed, obviously. Gonna stick to this and see how long it takes until they have eaten everything. So, pH and alkalinity crash in August. What's happened, really? Those following my channel might remember that in July the alkalinity was increasing and I was contributing it to denitrification in the bog filter. Obviously, when that happens, I stop adding the buffer to the system. And then I had 4 weeks of hard work on the filtering house and I wasn't paying attention enough. So in every water change I got it down a little bit. And I'm not sure what happened for the rest of it, but I do have a quite substantial nitrification going on, and that depletes the buffer. Anyway, when you face an alkalinity or a pH crash in your system, it's important not to rush things and start to buffering up very, very fast. Step number one is always, always checking the ammonia levels. Because if you take care of a pH crash with ammonia in your system, it will turn toxic immediately and risk the life of your fish. So I did check the ammonia, not really a problem with a big bog filter, as it depletes ammonia all the time. After that, I slowly increase 0.25 German hardness degrees every day. And after a little bit more than a week, I'm back to normal, and it wasn't really an issue as far as I can see for the fish or the health of the system. So, accident avoided. But please remember, always check ammonia before you add buffer to your system. So that's what I have for you in this episode. Being a koi keeper, there's always issues to take care of. The faster you take care of them, the better life you can give your fish. So until next time, thanks a lot for watching. Take care, stay safe. Bye.